Truck Talk Media.
C10 Talk, episode 242, 100 Square Body Auction, Big Fish Garage, Todd Carpenter, Dave Hall, Restore Muscle Car, good times ahead. Here we go.
I'm telling you, I had to buy a pallet of batteries before this auction, and I don't wish that on anybody. Yeah, so it was like roadkill on steroids for one day. We're like, we got to get everything right. We got a mile of trucks, and we got to all get them running. So, you know, we were in there getting everything because a lot of stuff has, you know, been sitting for a couple of years or whatever. I'm like, let's get this fired up and get whatever fixed and get her in line. And
damn, son. Seeing is believing. And our title sponsor, United Pacific, makes seeing a whole lot easier. The crispness of the United Pacific LED headlights, taillights, marker lights, and more makes seeing and showing your truck that much better. It's time to upgrade your old dim halogens for new LED headlights, taillights, and more. They offer the brightest and latest LED technology. Headlights are available up to 1600 lumens, easy to install, and it fits right in the OEM housing. How about upgrading to sequential taillights? They're DOT approved and ready to ship today. DOT approved. And for you 73 to 80 GMC and Chevy square body guys, they've got the new front parking lights LED with stainless steel bezel. Think UP Car Parts. That's upcarparts.com.
Let me tell you what Melbourne Post is packing right here. I've got 411 Posi Track Outback, 750 Double Pumper, Edelbrock Intake, Scored Over 30, 11-1 pop-up pistons, turbojet, 390 horsepower. We're talking some bucking muscle.
What does that do? Does that blow your mind? That just happened.
Welcome to C10 Talk, your C10 truck podcast.
And now I have a chance to be the best, maybe the best in the world.
My old man is a television repairman. Got this ultimate set of tools. I can fix it.
I said I got 50 cents in that jukebox, and all I can hear is your mouth clapping. You hear that?
Here's your host, Ronnie Wetch.
Here we go. Here we go. 242. Big T-O-double-D Todd Carpenter pulling it off. 100 Square Body Auction, Grand Island, Nebraska. Holy shit. What a good time. What a great time. Great hangs. Great people. It really does. It warms my heart that Todd pulled it off because it's something that I was over there 2 years ago, and I remember seeing the place, the trucks, the parts. And I think even before that, Todd had mentioned, man, what do you think about having a party here, maybe an auction? And you're like, yeah, okay, like let's do it, right? If you build it, they'll come, and we'll come to support you. That's what we do. I mean, that's what it's all about. So then as time kind of progresses, it's like, nah, I'm doing it. Like, I'm going to do it. And he absolutely did. He did it. So congrats, Todd Carpenter, your crew, your staff, your buddies, everybody. What an awesome event. Now, Restore a Muscle Car, Dave Hall, his crew, his staff, his people, they worked their asses off. They had to get like 40 different vehicles from Lincoln over to Grand Island. So just that alone is a chore. But it went great, and if there was a hitch, I didn't see one. All right, so the auction starts Saturday morning, just like they said, right around 9 o'clock. We go to the back 40 there, and they're going to start auctioning off some of the parts. I would say at the beginning, it was a little slow, and that's okay. It's got to build up a little momentum. The auctioneer was great. They got some truck cabs sitting there. They had some toppers, some shells, and the guy's like, come on, let's go, let's go. But once the parts started going, it started kind of picking up some steam, and that's probably a good way to start it. Wheels, some hubcaps, then they went into some different things like motors and all kinds of different parts that Todd had laid out, bumpers, grills, so on and so forth. For me, because I flew in, I didn't really want to buy any of those parts at that point because I didn't know if I would have the availability to get the parts home. So if they do it again, and I hope they do, man, I think I'm going to try to drive. It's a long drive, but It definitely opens it up. I guess if you know you're going to buy something, that's the key. It's almost like you wish it was a little bit reversed, because once you buy something, if you buy a truck, then you've got to get it home. And at that point, you're thinking, hey, Walt, can I load it up? Can I load up the back of this truck, the bed of the truck, the blazer, whatever it might be? In my case, I was bidding on some buckets and consoles, and I was getting outbid. And then a clapped out Jimmy, 1976, rusty as hell. And I bid on it and I won it. Bid 1700, got it. 1850 after some, you know, my 10% buyer's fee and some other taxes and some different fees. So clapped out Jimmy, and now I got to get it home. My plan was not to get it home. My plan was just to pull the parts off of it. I was going to pull the seats, front buckets, the console, the back seat, enough parts that I could just put in the back of a truck. Well, what ends up happening, Jeff, a local guy, he had driven out and he had a two-car hauler. And that night he's like, hey, I've got room. Do you got anything that needs to get back? And I'm thinking, man, I just need to pull these parts. But it was right there. So Sam had bought a truck. He had bought a few things. And so it just worked out. Sam threw on the 84-85 square body that he picked up. And then I threw on the Jimmy. And if it wasn't for Jeff, that wouldn't be possible. So I think for the $1,700, the $1,800, plus you know, transport fees, I've got a clapped out Jimmy coming home, and I'll be pulling off all the parts. I think the front bumper was pretty good, rear bumper, sport bumper. Obviously, I'll go through it. I'll probably just about get my value out of the parts. That's probably what'll end up working out if I don't get tetanus, and who knows, maybe I'll find a little gem in there. But that was what I would say, is if I would have known that I was going to have that Jimmy, I would have bought more stuff. I would have probably bought some wheels. I don't know about the hubcaps. They seem like they were a little pricey, but there might have been a few other things, especially some grills and different things that I would have bought earlier on. And nonetheless, I got a Jimmy and it's coming home. And that was fun. It was fun to be bidding on things, part of the action. You did pay $100 for your bidder's pass that got you in. It makes sense for them to do that, but being part of that action, it definitely was fun. Pricing. I felt like the lower end stuff went high. So stuff like, there was a chalet that was also clapped out. It did have a nice camper, but I think it went for like over 10 grand. I know it did. And there was a few other trucks that I was really surprised. Let's say a truck that I think is probably like 7,500 going for 98 to, you know, just over 10. So some of that auction, some of that excitement, people all surrounded around. So the auctioneers would move from truck to truck. And that's part of the party. That's part of the fun. And it brings up the prices. So I think the stuff that's cheaper, if you will, the under 15K stuff, probably went for a little higher than what I thought. The medium stuff, I think, was about right, maybe a little high. So I don't know. Is that a national thing where you have people coming from all over and that's the pricing, especially if they are part of the Rust Belt and then they see this and they're like, hey, this is worth more now because I don't have to do as much metal work, so on and so forth. It's hard to gauge it. There was some Kuwaiti bids and winners. So when you get that international stuff as well, the Desert Foxes, some of the other package trucks, the Stripe trucks, he had the Sarge, some Gentleman Jims. He had the Sport Coupe. He had just the Chevy Sport. So some of that stuff went international, and I think it probably went higher than what I would have thought. Sam got the Snow Chaser, which was cool. So we'll see what kind of shakes out with that. That's a very rare truck. He's bringing it back to the desert. So it'll be fun to kind of see what he does. You know, he tends to have fun with those projects, and will be included along the ride, his social media. So Snow Chaser coming back to Arizona. So under 15, probably a little high. Stuff from 15 to 25, probably, let's just say, a little high, but maybe just right. Overall, the stuff that I felt like kind of went cheaper would be the higher end stuff. So the Spirit of 76 4x4 went for like, let's just say $45,000. That blew me away. I felt like that truck would probably be the highest valued truck or the highest bidder, but it wasn't. The truck that ended up going for the most is the 49-mile 1977 C20, blue on baby blue, yellow trim. You open the door, it's like you're stepping into a 1977 Chevy GMC dealership. Bam. I mean, the smell, the whole thing, this thing was so pristine. I don't know who won it. That'd be fun to kind of do a follow-up. I'll have to talk to Todd, maybe the auction company, and see about some of these different vehicles. I've had people reach out and say, hey, I wonder who bought this. I wonder who bought this. The van, the 1979 Vandura, we had so much fun in that thing. We were definitely going to buy that thing. Probably 8 or sub 8. It was like at 6,200 on the proxy bid. So we kind of figured it would probably go for over 8. But at the end of the day, John, Sam, Carlos from Drop Lowered, myself, we're sitting in there, we're hanging out, and we're like, dude, how much fun would this van be? Let's make one trip with it, cross country. Let's go from NorCal to LST. The amount of shit that would go on and happen would just be so fun, and it would be worth it. But obviously, it went for over that. I think it went like about 10.5. I think it went to Texas is what I heard. So that thing was rad. The Outfitter. So that was the 76 Grecian bronze wood trim. It's on the cover of CK Magazine. That went for 50, I think 52 to 54. So just under the 77. Yeah, I thought that was probably a little high for that. But I think I was more surprised that the Outfitter went for more than the Spirit of 76. I guess that's how I'm looking at it. What else? There was a 6,000 mile truck that went for pretty good money that was right there. And then the other big one that I think a lot of people thought would be the highest grossing, highest selling was going to be the Outdoorsman, the 1985 with the gun, with the Winchester rifle that was included. A lot of the paperwork was there, and that one went for, I think, right at that 50 mark, 252, something like that. Dave Hall actually bought the Outdoorsman and the Spirit of 76. So he took home two of which could be the coolest trucks at the auction. We'll see if he keeps them. It sounded like he was hunting down that Spirit of 76 for a while. So we'll have to see what happens. Overall, just again, just to wrap it up, let's get into the interviews. So much fun. I'm glad I was able to go the first one. You know, that's one of the things John and I love talking about. If you can make it to the first ones, it doesn't disappoint. So this did not disappoint at all. I do look forward to going back if they host it. And I think I'd probably want to take something to sell. And then that means I'd have a truck and trailer so I could buy something and bring back some parts if they had them. I think it's going to be hard for Todd to get that much parts again because he had collected all those parts for a long time. And I feel like, you know, for the 1 year, but you know what, now that it's opened up, or if he does open it up, he might be able to have a lot more people bring in parts too. So we'll see what happens. All right. We've got a year to figure it out if they do it next year, and maybe they'll skip a year. I would say that they feel like they're going to skip a year, but as a few months go by, I could see Todd reconsidering that, but time will tell. We'll see. Okay, a few shows real quick, and then let's get into the interviews. The Slowdown, July 23rd. So that's out in West Coast, San Luis Obispo. You got C10s on the Capitol, Olympia, Washington, August 13th. And then the following weekend, you've got the Hoosier Truck Rally in Indiana. Their Instagram is Hoosier Truck Rally. Easy money. Check that one out. That's the 20th. So July 23rd, August 13th, and August 20th. All right, if this drops where it's supposed to, I'm on vacation. I'm on vacation with the family, and we just wrapped up 4th of July. Speaking of the Spirit of 76. All right, as always, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for your support. Have a great week, guys. Late. What up, what up? Hey, we are starting to wrap things up. I haven't been doing a lot of interviews during the actual auction. You got Jimmy, Second Chance Square Bodies. And he has a beautiful 84 with a 91 front clip. Kind of reminds me of the old monster truck. If you think Bigfoot,
The Chevy version was called Barefoot, but this thing is nothing but radical. I think the key is, Jimmy, you're local. You're a Nebraska guy, Omaha. You've been building square bodies your whole life.
Yep.
And now you're at 100 square body auction in essentially your backyard.
Right.
And you've done some work with Big Larry and T-O-Double-D and the crew. So thanks for taking time to be on the pod. What does this feel like to have all of us come out to Rhode Island, Grand Island, and just, dude, this is awesome. Trucks, weather, it doesn't get any better than this.
Well, it's just meeting other people, you know? Like, you coming all the way from home and coming here, and I think it's just fun meeting you guys, you know, from out of town, and seeing what other people's done to their trucks. You know, I've been doing this for 43 years, and building trucks, make them try to look good, make show trucks out of them, and that's all I like to do.
So in Omaha, and you've got, I mean, this thing looks like it's about a, I don't even know, 20-inch lift. It's big, 12, at least 12. So in Omaha, do you do mostly four-wheel drives, or what do you see? Do you guys have some two-wheel drives that come through? I see you got a beautiful little 78 two-wheel drive here. Do you, what are you seeing? When you think about square bodies, what are you building over there?
Just anything that people want to redo. You know, we take trucks out of junkyards and rebuild them to show quality. We start with the frames and work our ways up.
Do you find that it's better for you to have a couple, you know, in the back 40 to offer clients, or do they normally bring you their trucks?
They mostly bring me their trucks, and I have a few trucks out back. I'll take a fender off if they need a fender or a door. And I replace all the rockers and the cab corners on them because that's common in a square body. But this is what I love to do, is build square bodies, and they're a big hit right now, and I'm really surprised. And I like to travel more to all these other shows and show what I can do.
What's your favorite square body, favorite truck, favorite year? Are you a round eye guy? Are you a square headlight guy? What's your go-to?
I kind of like the 85s over and unders, but I'm liking the round eyes too. So it doesn't matter if it's 73 to 87, and you know, you got your 90-91 Blazer front clips, which I put on mine. It's just a fun time building these trucks and making the customers happy.
Yeah. So if I gave you any amount of money, what truck would you have bought here besides yours?
Well, if it was here, I'd probably buy Slice.
it was going to be here. Todd told me to bring it, and I didn't bring it. I should have brought it because this has been one amazing auction. You need to see that thing in person. It is hot potato.
Really?
I love that truck. All original striping. But here, we're not here to talk about my truck.
Slice.
We're here to talk about what you would buy.
We're
but
here to talk about
well,
Slice.
I mean, that's...
Slice is a very popular square truck.
It is.
Very popular.
It's super cool, and it's super rare.
Yes.
And I'm honored to have it. So I'm kind of glad I didn't bring it, but on one hand, I see what's going on here, and I think I probably should have. But, okay, I digress. So a lot of other trucks here, a lot of rad square bodies. Here's the deal, Jimmy.
Yeah.
I think that if we didn't have great guys like you out there wrenching, cutting, fabbing, meddling, then we wouldn't be so fortunate to see so many rad trucks.
Right.
That's first of all. Second of all, I think we're coming back because there's no way in hell that these guys don't do this so well, and this property and the way it's set up and the work that they did to not have this almost every year.
Well,
I'm hoping they do it every year because it brings people together, you know, all the square body guys. If he doesn't do it every year, maybe every 2 years, you know, but it brings people here.
Yeah.
And it's a fun time.
Yeah. We got vendors, you got, some shops set up, and, at the end of the day, I say it a few times, is it, the trucks bring us here, but the people keep coming back.
Right.
And it's, you meet the people, you get a couple cold ones, you break bread. We're going to have a band. It's going to be a good night.
Yeah.
We're glad you guys made it out. Where can we check you out online?
You can check us out on Facebook on Second Chance Square Bodies. Or we put on a show in August called CK Squares. You can go to that site and check out the Omaha area square bodies. Last year we had 210 squares. It's a free show. We don't charge. We want people to bring their squares. It doesn't matter if it's a rust bucket, used and abused, to top of the line show quality truck.
Do you have any parts there, like a swap meet area, or just truck, just a show?
We have a show. We have parts area, you know, a swap meet area.
And it's August or October? What'd you say?
August.
Okay, August what?
Usually we try to have it around August 25th.
Okay, and where is it located in Omaha? Like a fairgrounds or?
It's Springfield Fairgrounds in Omaha. Yeah, we're trying to put in the younger kids' minds that, hey, I like the square body. I'm going to go get one. Now I'm going to build it. Yeah. We had a couple of younger guys in their early 20s. They went out and bought square bodies out of a farmyard, and they posted on CK Squares that, hey, I'm building this for next year. I want to be at your guys' show. So we try to get sponsors. Restore is one of our big sponsors. And we just try to give away goodies for all the newcomers and have a good time.
Have a good time, bring the people together. Right. Jimmy, you guys can check him out. So it's Second Chance Square Bodies on Facebook, CK Squares on Facebook as well, yes, for the show. Yes. Any Instagram?
I'm on Instagram too. Second Chance Square Bodies on Instagram.
At c.k.squared.
At c.k.squared. All right, I'll find it, tag it. Thank you guys for coming out, and keep grinding. Can't wait to check out that show.
All right, I appreciate it.
Peace. Here we go, wrapping it up. 100 Square Body Auction. So I'm going to get caught up on some interviews, because we had some just amazing experience in the trucks. We got some buyers, we got some sellers. So I've got BJ Hasselman, who's out of Manhattan, Kansas, not to be confused with Manhattan, New York. The Little Apple. So he was saying Manhattan, Kansas is the Little Apple. BJ.
K-State Wildcats.
Oh, boy. K-State Wildcats.
Yeah, like
they were good at football for a while. They still are.
Right.
Who's the coach? What's the coach's name?
It was Bill Snyder.
Oh, yeah.
You think about it.
But no, it was Bill Snyder. I remember the older guy on the sidelines.
Yeah, yep.
Okay, the audience is like, oh, shit, they're talking college football.
Yeah, let's go.
Okay, let's get back to square bodies. I don't know what we're going to call this row, but it might be the million-dollar row, the square row, whatever it is. BJ had two trucks in the front row. That's all. It's the front row.
Yeah, and I appreciate that.
And it was awesome. Yep. So you had two of the raddest trucks here. You had an outdoorsman. Short bed, four-wheel drive,
the truck.
85, I believe. And then you had a 77 with 49.1 miles.
Yep.
So let's start with the outdoorsman. Or which one did you get first? Which one did you own first?
The outdoorsman we bought in September. We bought it from Matt Hooper in Down South Industries. Found it on the web and never owned something like that. I'm kind of like Todd. I like to have the rare stuff. So this is one that me and another guy went in together, got it sent to us, and we dumped some money into it to get it to look how it is now. But it had the gun with it, but it did not have the hat, the glasses, the scope. Got that all that stuff sourced. The only thing we're missing is the original box. So, but other than that, probably dumped about $6,000 into it, get it look the way it is, and it's a badass truck. Whoever owns this truck, which I know who bought the truck, but he told me yesterday he was going to buy it, and he did today. So, yeah, it's just an awesome truck. And when Todd – we actually bought it for Barrett in January of this coming year. And when Todd announced he was going to have this, I'm like, you know what, this truck would be badass there. Let's take it. And it's here. So it's awesome.
Yeah, so I think Dave bought it, right, from Restore Muscle Car.
He told me yesterday, he's like – he asked me the reserve, which it doesn't really matter, but he told me I want that truck, and I think I'm going to buy it, and he bought it. So he was a man of his word. Awesome.
Cool experience. It's cool because, like you guys even mentioned, you said it, Todd, you're not going to see a lot of outdoorsmen. especially one with the gun and everything else going on. Right. So it had, you guys had the Dick Butkus poster in there, right. All the stuff you had sourced it. Right. Are you happy with it? Are you happy with the experience of buying it, selling it, and just coming here and bringing the truck?
You know, this started out as a hobby 10 years ago, as everything kind of does. And we were buying stuff, and I was dragging stuff out of the weeds, cleaning it up and reselling. And it's starting to get to where it used to be, you know, $500,000 trucks. Now it's, you know, $50,000 trucks. But it's fun. Just meeting the people, like all these guys that I knew on Facebook. Like, I didn't know Todd. I'd never met Todd in person until 3 weeks ago. And it's like him and I were like, we literally could have met each other for 10 years. And I'm sure everybody, you know, you, same way. You know, I listen to your podcast and it's awesome. And just the truck world, you know, we're just, we're Squarebody C10 guys, and we love it, man.
Yeah, it's awesome. 1985, the Outdoorsman. I think it has like 40-some thousand original miles.
44, 45, something like that, yeah. And actually, when we bought that thing, and Matt did us a good job. He sold it to us right, delivered it and everything, but we were going to put it back down, repaint it, restripe it, make it 100% original. And then the more we were looking at it, I'm like, you know what? It's got the patina. It's got the 6-inch lift. It looks tough. It's got the gun. Let's just leave it the way it is. And I mean, it speaks for itself. So
totally. And I think it went for 40 something.
44.
$44,000. 1985 Outdoorsman. There's Dave right there. We're gonna hit him up because he's got a couple rigs. He bought the Spirit of 76 too. So I'm gonna hit him up. Okay. On to the 77. Got to be one of the coolest trucks. Yep. A pure time capsule. Thing is just legit. I love that color combo, a 77 with the gold trim. Yep. It's the blue on baby blue. How did that truck fall into your lap?
So, you know, if you keep digging, you're going to find gold, right? So I've known about this truck for 5 years. It came from my hometown in Abilene, Kansas. A lot of people, you know, the internet's crazy because a lot of people don't believe it actually has 49, but as you know, you looked at it, you can legit see what it is, right?
I posted it one day and it was so funny to kind of look at the comments. They undid the Speedo, they rolled it back, all kinds of shit. So it's kind of funny to look at the comments.
No, it's, so we've known the family forever. They're, you know, Abilene's like 6,000 people. And I found out about 5 years ago, one of the brothers that his father had bought this truck brand new, actually passed away, and they had an estate sale for him. And I bought like three or four trucks there in a car, and my aunt, cousin, and you know, a lot of us bought stuff from that estate. And at the time, they told me about this truck, and I'd never seen it, and I heard rumor about it. Well, fast forward, I just kept in touch, right? Yeah, you've always heard the old adage, if you just keep in touch, right? So about a year ago, I was like, hey, you know, if you want, I can take it to Barrett or I can clean it up. I didn't plan on buying it, actually. And then this auction was coming up. I sent it to Todd. I sent it to some other big truck guys. And Todd's like, you got to bring that thing up here. He's like, you got to bring it up here. And so I'm like, all right. So Dad and I went and looked at it again. And Dad's like, why don't we just buy it? And for all of you out there, and Ronnie, you too, you know, your dad, whether he's with you still or not, my dad still is, thankfully, but he loves going on these truck runs with me and going out into some pasture and grabbing a truck. He looks forward to it. He's retired. And so I don't even give a shit what the money, excuse me my language, but I don't give a shit what the money is, the time with my dad, because, like, you know, that's irreplaceable. So that's why I kind of had to keep going and making sure we were both okay on what it sold for. And it went to a guy that Todd had actually given me a number to the guy.
North Dakota. They just fired up a Mustang. I think it went to North Dakota. So we'll let this. Oh, hold on. We're peeking like crazy. Sorry, guys. All right, we're gonna start from a guy that you went to, because I'm gonna have to edit that out. So
yeah, I apologize for that. So anyway, it went to a guy in Michigan that has actually the same exact truck, but a half ton with 110 miles on it. Same color scheme, the ZY5 package, the V20, you know, everything. And so that's cool. But how we found this truck is, so we went and looked at it, and like I said, we just kept in touch, and two brothers, and Dad and I, we sat and made the deal. And the cool thing about it is they thought, you know, when you buy something, you kind of feel bad if you're going to resell it, because a lot of people think you're just going to take it to car shows. Well, that truck does not need to be driven. I did not want it to hit 50 miles. That's why You know, the most it got driven was me bringing it here off the trailer and parking it in Todd's shop. And anyway, these guys are huge into wrestling. They're huge wrestlers. Abilene has a huge wrestling program, so we are actually giving a percentage of the proceeds to one of the brothers. He's got a scholarship that had actually passed away, to his scholarship, and then two to the wrestling program in Abilene. So
here comes some kids. They're dragging a cooler. We got all kinds of background. Hey, I want to kind of back up a little bit, because you were talking some about taking pops out, right? And I met your dad. Yeah. And thinking about what's so cool about that. And I don't know that I've really ever thought about this, but how cool is it that you think about when you grow up, we sit shotgun with pops, right? With dad. And then we love those trucks, right? Well, now he's sitting shotgun with you.
Yeah, he does.
And
he,
so if you're a dad, he's tickled. He's like, I'm with my boy, and we're chasing down trucks.
Right.
Does it get any better than that?
So I'm blessed because that's right. I'm blessed because my wife and I, we have our own businesses. We work from home. We have the luxury of not working corporate world. You know, my brother, which is 3 years younger, he only lives a mile away from my dad, and they're close, but he works the corporate world, right? So I can take off in the middle of the day and just go pick him up and go out to the middle of nowhere and pick up a truck. So, yes, you're correct with that, and it's just something like if you're not able to buy your dad lunch at this point in life, then, you know, you're kind of doing something wrong. But my point to that is dad still has his 1979 Silverado. He bought it as a year old in 1980. It was a 5.7, factory 5.7 diesel, half ton, white. They call it Old Whitey, and my brother's. So we still have that truck. But the thing about that truck and these trucks here is a lot of people don't understand. These were people's everyday. You know that, Ronnie, right? Every day, they didn't have the luxury of having crew cabs and all that other bullshit, right? So we would hop, he'd put the topper in the back, and we'd hop in the back of it, and that's how we rode all the way to Colorado or wherever, you know. So, and we still got that truck, and he instilled us, you know, hard work, and you can afford stuff like this, but, you know, you come from humble beginnings, and yeah, so.
You get to experience that with your dad. That's the coolest thing. That's invaluable, like you said, you know. And speaking of giving back, you're giving back to the kids.
We're giving back now.
So overall, this experience with the 77, I think that now this guy's, it's going to Michigan, mm-hmm. and you did already know him, that you had already had contact with him.
I did not call him. Todd gave me his number, but I was so, like, that's one reason I actually didn't want the truck, because my plate is so full that I, like, it did not look like it does now. It was so covered. We spent 2 weeks on getting it the way it is. But Todd could give me the guy's number. I completely forgot about it, and then he told me today that's where it's going, which is great. And we had a strong offer from a guy in Georgia, but the truck was already in the auction, and I didn't want to, like, ruffle any feathers and pull. And Todd, good dude, you know that. He's like, dude, do whatever. I just want it here so people can see it. And I'm like, you know what? It's already on proxy bid. It's got bids. It would not be right of me to pull that truck, right? I mean, so I'm like, let's just leave it.
Okay, so we're going to move a little bit. We got some just audio, so a little bit less background. I think the cool thing is, too, that you made the decision to drop the reserve. So at one point, right, you dropped the reserve on it, and
we dropped the reserve, and it went up $4,000.
Was that like 50-something, and then you
it
said
it
was
like 52, it went to 56. So the thing is we didn't have to sell the truck, and that's a beautiful place to be, is like the outdoors didn't have to sell. And the 77 didn't have to sell. However, we had some strong money on both of them. We made great money, and the fact that we're able to sell the 77 and give back to some people on that, and Dave bought the. He told me yesterday he wanted it. So.
And overall, are you happy with the experience? Did you have a good first 100 square body experience? You brought two of the absolute gems, and I'll tell you right now, two of the trucks that a lot of people were talking about. The Outdoorsman had a ton of hype. I think the Spirit of 76 had good hype. The Outfitter had good hype. And then I say the 77 might have had the most hype because it's such a low mile, rare truck. When you open the door for the audience, you knew right away. I mean, it literally was like you were at the dealer as a kid jumping around, you know, in and out of this truck. You could tell. So overall, I got to feel like you're going home pretty happy.
Yeah, we're going home happy. I just want to give a shout out to Todd. I mean, the dude was awesome. You know, when we initially made this deal on the Outdoorsman, it was $500 to put a truck in, and then they changed it because they had to. Because I think, you know, I even asked Todd the other day, did you ever think it'd get this big in your mind when you were? And he's like, I had no freaking idea, right? And they had to change some things because, you know, this is a huge thing, and they had, you know, bills got to be paid. So, but he upheld his deal we made together to put the Outdoorsman in, and that's why it was still in here. Versus taking it to Barrett or whatever, but and the fact that people can, like, I had so many people come up to me and be like, I can't believe you brought these trucks, and I'm so glad you did, because seeing stuff like this that you only hear about, and that's what I, dude, I'm telling you, people were telling me that all day long, and I'm like, you know what, you know, it's, we got to own them, grateful to own them, and we just, you know, want to pass them on, and I really appreciate it. No, Ronnie, there's guys on here that I'm Facebook friends with, and this is like 10 years in the making of bringing shit here, and yeah, it's so I am going to C10s in the park. Got my two tickets. I was able to get them, and we're bringing a couple trucks. Nothing as crazy as this, but some trucks we're bringing. So
what's your social media?
So on Instagram it's Flint Hills Square Bodies, and on Facebook it's Flint Hills American Classics, because I do deal in. You know, I just sold a 62 Impala, and it went to Sweden. So I do deal in that kind of stuff, but Square Bodies is kind of my forte.
Flint Hills.
So in Manhattan, we're called the Flint Hills. And it started as a hobby, and I just was trying to think of a name, and now Facebook won't let me change it because I have another name, but whatever, it is what it is. But so Flint Hills Square Bodies on Instagram, and Flint Hills American Classics on Facebook, because I can't change the name because Facebook's dumb, but whatever. So yeah, you just follow me on Instagram. I try to post a lot there, and especially in my stories, and I've been posting a lot with the stuff here. But just follow me on Instagram. And in fact, speaking of Instagram, Ronnie, thankful to you, Squarebody USA, Todd, a couple other guys that I actually grew 100 people on Instagram within like freaking 2-3 days.
But he's blowing it up, right? So hey, well, it's gonna blow up now. People are gonna check it out. So you guys go online, check it out. Flint Hill Squares, and then Flint Hill Auto Classic, yeah, Classic Hill's Autos.
Yeah, if you just go Flint Hills Auto or whatever, you'll see me. Or just go to my BJ Hasselman, my Facebook page, and it says right there.
Okay, BJ, thanks for taking your time to be with us. Congrats, and I love the part of you and your dad, and that he was here. He was here to experience that for the audience. I don't know that we even said that. He went and picked up trucks with you, but he was here, and I could tell when I talked to him, there was a twinkle in his eye. There was a little that he was here for that, so good for you.
Yeah, I appreciate it, buddy. He's retired, and you know, your dad's always going to be your hero regardless of whatever happens. And I had to do something to get him out of the house and kind of give him something to, a passion. And
Here we go.
He's the reason that we have that 77. He's like, why don't we just buy it? And here it,
you know, it works out. BJ, thanks for your time. I appreciate it, brother. Thanks.
So you bought a C10 and it either had AC at one time or it wasn't even an option. Well, Vintage Air has the solution for you. Their SureFit kits are designed to place the evaporator and hoses behind the dash for a factory clean look. In most cases, the SureFit systems will be controlled by your stock dash controls using their exclusive cable converters. The Gen 4 kit provides infinite just right temperature, air blending, and blower fan speed adjustments. The Vintage Air SureFit kits are the best value and the most completely engineered air conditioning system you can install in your C10. Add the fact that Vintage Air has been the most respected name in performance aftermarket climate control systems for 40 years. 40 years? Damn, son. The choice is obvious. VintageAir.com.
Hey, guys. I've got Joe Rode, Classic Performance Products, CPP back. Joe, let's talk X10 spindles. Go.
Yeah, you know, CPP's one of our most popular parts through the years has been our 2.5-inch drop modular spindles. Really popular part. Well, we've kind of taken that to the next step. You know, we've emulated late model Corvette, Silverado, Chevy technology into our new X10 drop spindles. They use a steel hub, sealed bearing hub, really strong piece.
As you know, Joe, so many guys are building bigger trucks, bigger wheels, bigger brakes, everything bigger and better. Is this X10 something they should be considering?
Oh, absolutely. It's oversized bearings. Definitely great for a guy using big brakes, big wheels, which I'm sure all your guys are.
All right, guys, there you go. If you're looking to upgrade, you need a new spindle anyways, you're going to lower your truck, you're running a bigger wheel, a bigger brake, CPP's got it for you with their new X10 spindle. Joe, as always, thank you. CPP, classicperform.com. That's classicperform.com.
Marque has been in business for over 40 years. It all started in the original owner's garage. From humble beginnings of a couple parts in a garage to a two-building manufacturing facility making over 6,000 parts, Marque has grown to be one of the country's premier truck parts manufacturers. They not only design the products, but also design the tooling to build the products, guaranteeing quality control. They have made their original parts from the original trucks. Aluminum strips are double polished, creating a mirror finish, and crystal clear anodized. They use the highest quality, hand-selected, show-quality wood that will hold up over time. Why? Because it's kiln-dried to precision moisture levels specifically for Marque. They stock oak, pine, and mini exotics, guaranteeing extremely fast delivery. All parts are manufactured in-house in Oklahoma City, USA. They offer quality parts built by Americans for old American-made trucks. So when you're looking for body moldings, bed strips, bed wood, and so much more, think Marque. That's mar-k.com.
What up, what up? We are wrapping it up. We've got the band in the background, 80s vibe, 80s music. I've got Dave Hall, Restore a Muscle Car here, who is probably maybe not a 50%er on this deal, but at least a 30%er with Todd. What do you think about this auction? You guys kicked ass. I'm sure it's been a ton of work for you. Every time I get on social media, it seems like you guys are bringing a load of trucks here. You had to get them from Lincoln. But Nebraska itself, I mean, in the middle of Nebraska, we're partying, and we've had a great time, and you guys had a great auction.
Thanks. Yeah, actually, everything went extremely well. My staff and myself, we spent a lot of time putting a lot of stuff together with everything to kind of build up to this, to help with the sale. Todd worked his ass off here getting everything ready for the event, from concrete to fencing to rock, you name it. And while we focused on marketing and advertising and the website and just trying to bring all the cool, fun, one and only vehicles, you know, that were going to be available at this sale and stuff for sale. So, you know, and trying to just let the world know what we were trying to put together here, and obviously a first time event for a lot of cool square bodies, and then the generations before and after it and stuff to help kind of tie it in. But, you know, yeah, we brought ourselves just shy of 40 some vehicles out here to the sale. And which is, you know, it's almost a 2-hour haul one way from Lincoln, but it worked out well. Brought a lot of nice stuff. We sold 75% of our pieces here, a couple pieces going home, but we bought a couple nice ones too.
Yeah, and I want to talk to you about what you purchased, but before we get to that, I think, yeah, it definitely, you guys, what an undertaking. And I know it's been for the entire time I've known Todd, he's wanted to have a party here, right? So it's an auction with a party with an auction. You guys did it. You talked a little bit about the reach, the marketing. It's crazy with the proxy bid that we're getting these bids that are coming in. We're getting Kuwait, we're getting, you know, Saudi, and people are loving what's going on here.
Yes.
But again, there's some domestic. We got North Dakotas and Michigans, and yep. I heard all kinds of different states, you know, that were bidding on stuff and winning stuff as well. I think the way that it flowed was really well. We had the Pope Mobile, and Todd was doing his thing, giving his spill each round, which was really a nice thing to have that addition.
Yep.
Overall, I mean, for the audience, it's crazy to think that you could, and maybe we don't know, maybe Dave knows, maybe Todd knows, but it didn't seem like there was really any problems. Even the weather with the sprinkle or the rain last night was a good thing.
It was all a good thing. I mean, in all reality, everything for the most part really went our way as best as it possibly could. I mean, yes, there were some predictions for storms all day today earlier in the week, so we had some concerns with that. Last night we had to scramble and put some stuff inside because there was some call for some hail coming in. So we did that, but it ended up dissipating before it even got here, and just ended up getting sprinkles into the morning, and it worked out good, which actually brought the temperature down. We had a little bit of a breeze. Sun still came out. So, I mean, you couldn't ask for a better day. a better time getting everything put together. You know, Todd's crew here has helped out tremendously with keeping track of everything from keys to moving vehicles to trying and getting things in order to try and keep everything safe, keeping everybody out of harm's way. I mean, the food, the security, everything just actually flowed very nicely. We had a lot of people come up to us at our display today and just tell us how well they thought the event was run. You know, for as many people that we had here and as many things as we had going on, as many vehicles that we had to deal with in a one-day sale, and everything just kind of leading up to it, and everybody felt really comfortable and thanked us for being a part of it. Especially, we had a lot of sponsors involved in this event, and for being a first time, you know, around, a lot of support.
It was crazy too, because I wasn't sure on a timing, right? We think it's gonna go the way it's gonna go. Oh, from, I know it from 10 to 1 parts, and then from 1 to 9, and it worked out. It was like they got to where they needed to be, yes, and the time they needed to be where they needed to be. So it really, it worked out. It worked out, everything worked out. Even with the rain and the back 40, it allowed for the dust to be kind of knocked down. So it was a great vibe. And I assume that your head and your brain is just already cranking for 2023.
Oh yeah, I mean, I never stop thinking about what we can do and how we can do things better. I'm involved in a lot of different events throughout the year, I have been, and we've had Restore Muscle Car for over 17 years now. Before that, I owned software development companies and was into computer science, and so an analytical mind and looking at things a lot differently, both before and after, and then also how we can redefine things and make things better. But things went really well for this event. We got a lot of input from the right people, a lot of experience from before. But at the same time too, moving forward and what we can do next year or years to come for an event like this, I think is definitely a possibility, or a very strong possibility. I mean, first of all, we're gonna have a party whether Todd wants to have one or not, because he loves having all of his buddies here. And now I got a lot of new buddies and stuff that I have got to meet and know. And, you know, to be able to bring a lot of trucks here that we all love and enjoy, you know, why not do it again? Even if we may not have as many ourselves, we're going to have a lot of other people that want to have their trucks brought here and have it be a part of the sale.
Perfect. Yeah, it's going to be awesome. A couple trucks that you ended up picking up that are a couple of my favorites from the show. You got the Outdoorsman. We'll start there. What a rad truck. Was that something that was on your radar from the beginning, or were you like, wow, it's the whole package?
You know, the Outdoorsman, something I've always known about. I never really had an opportunity to buy one. You know, one of my techs, Tyler, he's a very avid gun. He'll design and build guns in the shop and stuff. We'll take them apart and do Cerakoting and stuff like that. So he's always into that. So he's gotten me into guns, and then having a truck that's tied with a gun and having it being the original pieces, you know, was a huge, huge factor, obviously. And then it being I love blue, and it's a really cool truck with a lift that it just looked badass. And so it's like, why not, you know, at least take the opportunity and see if I couldn't win it. And we did, and super psyched about it. It'll add we already have a really good collection now, but it's gonna add to a very nice collection, and along with the other piece that we got here as well.
One of the trucks that's in your collection that was right next to that truck was the low mile 8586. And were you surprised were you happy with that truck? Because I was really, I mean, the two low mile trucks, right? That one with the 6,000, 6,500, and then the 49 miler. So I think that truck did really well. I like the exterior, the interior threw me off. But overall, right next to your Outdoorsman was another rad blue truck, and it was your truck. I mean, that truck it was pretty awesome.
87, you know, K10, black with the blue stripe down the middle with the, I think, mahogany interior, 4-speed, 6,000 miles, an unbelievable truck. It wasn't something I had originally planned on bringing here to sell. I was thinking about in the future maybe taking it somewhere else if I was going to sell it, but it turned out right here. And then plus I kind of had some visions of buying a couple other vehicles and stuff too, but it was an outstanding truck. It was a beautiful truck. You know, I think it probably could have did a little bit better, but at the same time too, you know, I'm all about moving on, and let's get something different, because you know, it's a sickness with having these trucks and cars and stuff like that. We want to keep them and have them all, but at the same time too, it's nice to enjoy different pieces.
Well, and you get rid of that one, and then another door. Oh, you know, one door closes, one door opens, right? So right next to that, Spirit 76. A truck that I feel like really has identified who Todd is for so long.
Yes, yeah.
I know it probably was a tough one for him to sell,
yeah.
But I do think it's cool that you got it. It stayed here kind of in Nebraska, at least for now. And what a cool truck to have to your collection.
You know, the Spirit of 76 has been something I've been trying to buy from Todd for a long time. And it was never anything, obviously, that he wanted to sell. And you're right, it definitely helped define him and get him noticed with, you know, having that piece in his collection. And I have another Spirit of 76. It's a white one at my shop. It's a short bed, four-wheel drive, rust-free Arizona truck that we're in the process of restoring. And so to get this blue one, I think it's going to be pretty neat when I get the white one done to have the two of them next to each other. And it's, you know, red, white, and blue, you know, you can't get anything more, definitely more American. And then a short box four-wheel drive, I'm all about. You know, growing up, I always had a K5 Blazer and a Trans Am in my garage. And the short box trucks are my next favorite as far as, and it has to be, I love 4x4s. I mean, yeah, I have a couple of two-wheel drive Blazers and stuff in my collection that are super low mileage that are, you know, hard to find, but at the same time too, I love 4x4 stuff.
Yeah, I could tell. All right, well, I'm gonna let you go. So what's up next? We're pretty much at the halfway mark of the year. What's going on for Dave Hall and Restore Muscle Car? What do you guys got coming up on the horizon?
Oh, we always got a lot of stuff going on here. Actually, within the next 3 weeks, we're doing another auction in Lincoln at the Pinnacle Arena. So it's an indoor stadium, and it'll be air conditioned. There'll be food, alcohol, everything. But it's open to all classic cars, and that's the 15th and 16th of July. We did it 3 years ago in Lincoln and had a great turnout. We had just shy of 300 cars and had a 75% sale rate. So we help a lot of local people out that just want to move some vehicles on. And right now, with our economy kind of going through some weird stuff right now, possibly heading into a recession, we hope not. But at the same time, too, it's a perfect time for somebody to be able to cash out on something and put some money into something else. But we have, you know, multiple events going on, from Barrett Jackson coming up, a few other car shows. And then we have an event that we do every year called the Bandit Run that I started back in 2007. And it was, I worked with Burt Reynolds for over a decade, helped him with his cars. Anytime he was at Barrett Jackson, it was because of us. And so he was a very big part of that event with us, and we helped kind of get him out of the acting Hollywood world and into the car world, which he never got to experience how nice car people are. And bringing the Bandit Run, you know, to him, to his place, actually 2 months before he passed, we had a huge blowout party down at his house and stuff, and at a big restaurant and stuff down there, and it all went really, really well.
When is the Bandit Run? When do you guys do that?
The Bandit Run is actually something we typically do every spring or first part of the summer. It's obviously based on the Smokey and the Bandit movie. We originated going from Texarkana to Atlanta, just like Burt did. We changed the route every year, except for every 5 years we go back to Texarkana to Atlanta, and then we'll maybe change up some spots in between. This year was the 45th anniversary of the movie. They're now playing the Smokey and the Bandit movie in theaters again, and we've got a you know, probably a couple hundred cars and 400 to 500 people that go on this road trip with us every year. We bring in new people and get to meet a lot of new people. I've got friends in every state across the nation because of cars, because of the events that we're a part of and the things that we do. And car people in general are cool. You give them the key to your house, the key to your car, and you know that they're not going to, you know, steer you wrong. So,
yeah, that's awesome. What a fun thing. One of the things you said, I think that I'm going to, in my mind, you had a K5 Blazer and a TA or a Camaro or something,
yep,
in the garage.
Yep.
So you grew up right. And obviously the tradition continues with what you guys have going on. So for our audience, they'll stay tuned. You guys are moving, shaking. You got all the media guys here. I'm going to speak for Todd. It probably wouldn't have been the success that it was without, you know, your team, your help. So you guys did an awesome job. So thank you for bringing 40 plus vehicles here, some really high-end trucks, Blazers, a lot of cool rigs, and it sounds like it was a success.
Yes, it was a great team effort, and we all have had our specialties that we were good at, and we bantered a lot of back and forth to make sure that we could put on a great event that everybody that traveled a long ways would enjoy.
Yeah. All right, Team Nebraska, Dave, thanks for your time. Appreciate it, and can't wait to kind of continue to watch everything you guys have going on.
You bet. Thank you, 100squarebodyauction.com.
Boom. Nice plug.
Team Nebraska.
Sitting in the office, enjoying the good life, wrapped up, and we are here at the 100 Square Body Auction. We have Channing Stutzman, and Channing, who has been on the pod, he usually comes out with T-O-double-D to Barrett Jackson, and he's one of those guys who is probably a little bit more behind the scenes, but you had a big role in the success of this auction. I'm sure Todd would, or will, hopefully I get a chance to interview him, but he's out kissing babies and partying. The band's in the bay, and they're partying right now. But so I've got Channing here, and I thought I would, who better to kind of interview from the perspective of the behind the scenes and everything that's been going on. Once Todd had this pipe dream, we all heard it. It was something that Todd's been talking about for years. But he made it happen, and he made it happen with a kick-ass team. So you can mention other people like JP and Race, I don't know, Paint Chip and the whole group, but the head pimp is Channing. So take it from here. Let us know what you think about this crazy auction and the success of the first, what I was calling the Big Fish Auction.
Well, I just want to start off and say that this is a big thing that me and Todd say every time when we look at each other. The whole time we're like, you know, we're gonna do it. We did it. He came up to me tonight, he's like, you know what, we did it.
We did it.
We killed it. I mean, the turnout, it exploded so much. We had no idea what it was gonna turn into. When we talked about it, we're like, oh, it's gonna be a great idea, it's gonna go viral, it's gonna go crazy, you know. And then when we started getting into it, slowly getting into it in the beginning, we're like, you know, it'll be all right. You know, it'll be a pretty decent turnout. And then it's just every day more and more happened. I mean, like, just it took off on the social media, and then all of a sudden the news came in. And then all of a sudden, you know, we sat down one night and Todd's like, T-O-double-D came right up to me and he's like, Channing, sit down. And I'm like, all right. You know, I don't like him when he says that. It's either really good or really bad. But I thought this one was bad. And he's like, I think I might have bit off more than I could chew. And I want to say this was, I want to say it was Tuesday. Yeah.
Tuesday.
So we had.
And today's Saturday.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, you know, you have your highs, your lows. It goes, you're up, you're down, you know, like, oh, you run into an issue. And all of a sudden you got a low and you're getting beat up. And people are talking about, You're always going to get negative feedback when you have a big event, you know. You know, they say, everybody always says, you know, haters fuel everybody, you know. And it does, but that's sometimes, it beats you down, you know. Like, you're just trying to have a good time. The biggest thing that we wanted to do is we wanted to get all of our friends to come and see us. Every year, there's so many events, and we're going to see them, you know. We finally brought them here, you know. We gave everybody a reason to come here. It was great. I mean, and like I said, Ronnie told me to give some shout-outs. The list goes on and on, but you got Race, you got Jared Pledrup, JP, you got Big Larry, you got, you got Chase Christensen. I mean, I know I'm going to forget some people. Don't get mad if I do. It's been a long day. But, yeah, like I'm gonna throw some names out when they come to my head. I already know, we got Rusty. I mean, I could go on and on and on with names, but it's everybody. It was my brother, my business partner, Steel by Stets. That's a plug. Anyway, we took the week off, and Zach, and so we got Zach. He's our employee. He's a younger kid. He loves the trucks. They're into the trucks. We call him the truck game. We actually call him the clapped out convoy or something. They got a different name, but we beat them up. They're good kids though. All his buddies, they come down. Like I said, team effort. Just a great, great deal. I know I'm probably getting sidetracked. You got to ask me another question, Ronnie.
No, you did good. I wanted you to talk about all the different folks, to thank them. But you know, it was a collective effort. But you nailed it. You brought the party to Grand Island, and it was an amazing auction. I think the key is to know that there is a lot of working parts behind the scenes, and it's not just Todd, and it's just not Meyer, and it's not just Dave Hall or whatever, right? There's guys, the minions, and you're the head minion, and all the things that you're doing nonstop, and the things that you did to make this facility from the rock and the fence and the concrete, and now, I mean, it's got to be duplicated in the perspective, and we've told Todd and we've mentioned it to Dave. But and they don't need to listen to us, but I know they want to, and the people came. It's the exact same. If you build it, they will come, and they did come. You guys kicked ass, and now you're probably gonna have to say, all right, in June 25th, we're gonna start having the big fish auction, and that auction entails you working your ass off. Is pretty much what I'm saying.
Oh yeah, exactly. As much as we say it's not going to happen, I really feel like it's going to be a yearly, maybe a bi-yearly thing. Like I said, like Ronnie said, so much behind the scenes. And it is. If you build it, they will come. And if you build it right, a lot will come. There's so much to it. And then the other thing is, there's just so much that we saw throughout how this process went. Things that we would change, but we learn. And what I think is, I only think it could get better. I don't think it's gonna be hard, because I mean, we killed it right off the first time. I mean, just to throw this thing together, and that's the thing, everything with Todd is last minute, and that's the big thing we always joke about. My wife just hammers on me about it. She's like, you stress yourself out so much. That's the only reason we get things done, is because it has to be done. Like, we are not planners by any means. It's like, if we say we want something, the biggest joke is, I bought a house. Todd talked me through this. And I live by this off of him. Go buy the house. Tell him you'll take it. Say it's sold. Figure out how you're going to get the money. You don't have the money. He's like, Channing, we know you ain't going to save up no money. You ain't going to save it. You blow it. So just buy the house. Figure out how to come up with the down payment and say you're going to do it. Same way the auction went.
So you just said and admitted that you're a normal male. That's what people do. That's what guys do.
Yeah.
Every day. It's like, sure, we can plan on saving and plan on this, but people who overthink things just don't do things. You just do it and you figure it out.
Yeah.
That's what guys do, and that's what truck guys do, and that's normal. And it's like, once you figure out that you can do it that way, you're like, well, why do I need to do it, play it safe all the time and have this money for this and do this? I just do it and figure it out. And it's funny because my wife drives her crazy that's how I am. And that's why men are from Mars and women are from Venus, or whatever the hell the book is. We don't look at things as analytical, and we're just like, fuck it. This is what I'm going to do, and I'll figure it out. I'll make it work. It's just what we do. We adapt. You guys, again, I'll take you out on this, but I just feel like not only you guys and the team, but you specifically, Channing, you did an amazing job. This wouldn't have happened without you. You need to hear that. You need to know that. You need to get credit for that. And think about it for the audience. You know, they're taking time off. You have a company, and you're taking time off. So I don't know that that'll happen every time or every year, and it really can't. But at the same time, no different than like Sam and I throwing the reunion, you might think that you're not going to take time off, but it becomes so overwhelming that you're like, something's got to give. And I've already said I'm going to do the auction, so this is what we're going to do, and this is how we're going to do it. But again, you guys nailed it. You pulled it off. What would you say, and I'll kind of take you out with this, what would you say was the hardest part?
The hardest part was, we kind of had to judge how many people were going to show up. So you kind of got to base everything off that. And then the other thing is just there was like a few hard things. The other thing was weather. All right. So you got all these interior parts. You have nice pieces. We have a gated in area. It's barbed wire fence everywhere around it. But you're out on the edge of town. You can't put stuff out. So you run into, it's time constraints. It was the people being there at the right time, trying to move the material, trying to go through the material that, like I said, the other thing was with the people, just like, where were we going to put everybody? How far did we need to space the trucks apart? Where were we going to put all the trucks? What were we going to do to make it great for everybody? That's like the hardest part was not how well was the auction going to flow. The whole thing we're thinking in our heads the whole time is, what is going to piss people off and what can we do to stop pissing people off? Like, that's what it is. It's like the thing that I said today, I don't know how many times I said it, is everybody's like, hey, Channing, what are you doing? Hey, like, I don't even want to know how many times I heard my name. I had people call me different names just so I didn't have to hear my name that many times. I love it. Don't get me wrong. Yes, Ronnie. Yes, Todd. They know that I love Channing, 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 Channing. Today, you know what? I am tired of my name. I am tired of hearing my name. But it's just like, but the big thing that I said all the time was, like, what are you doing, Channing? And I'm like, just trying to fight fires, putting out fires. I was trying to be Ronnie today, you know? I just wanted to put out fires. I wanted to be a hero. I tried my hardest. I think I did a great job. I think the team did a great job. Like I said, shout outs to everybody. I know I didn't shout out for Dave and Tyler and all his guys behind the scenes with the media and everything. But it was a team deal, and I think the team worked great together, and I think that's what made it work. So, like I said, a lot of behind the scenes. Dave, Todd, all them guys, they did what they need. Everybody did what they needed to do, and they made it great. And I, you know what? It's probably going to happen again. Todd's gonna bust me up for saying that. I want you guys all to beat him up, because as much as I bitched about this whole thing, I would love to do it again. But guess what? I ain't scheduling any buildings in June.
I don't think it's not going to happen. I think you guys are going to probably do it again. We're definitely thinking you need to do it again. And the funny reason why everybody was calling Channing's name today was because Todd was in the Popemobile. So he's literally in a little cage in the back of a pickup truck. So you couldn't really get to Todd. It was hard to get to Todd. So when you can't get to Todd, who are you going to go for? Well, his right-hand man, and that was you. So I know you don't want to hear Channing too much anymore. We're going to take you out, and we're going to take you out in style. Suck it, Channing. Great job, dude.
Thanks, bro.
When you're looking for classic Chevy or GMC truck parts, BrothersTrucks.com is your number one source for 1947 to 87 Chevy and GMC truck restoration parts. So whether you are restoring an original or looking to customize that classic truck, BrothersTrucks.com has thousands of the highest quality truck parts for you to choose from. So head over to BrothersTrucks.com and order your free catalog today. And don't forget to follow Brothers on Facebook and Instagram for daily updates and special offers too.
Hey guys, are you thinking about swapping out your old motor for a more reliable LSLT-based power plant? We've got great news for you. PSI Conversion is offering our listeners 10% off your order. Behind each PSI harness, you get over 10 years of experience in the business, online tech support, phone support, and harnesses made in the U.S. That's PSIconversion.com. And don't forget, use code C10TALK and save 10% today.
Hey guys, I've got Andrew from Painless Wiring on. Andrew, what's the latest?
Just working on producing these GM truck harnesses, our best moving vehicle specific. And we're just, you know, super excited to be able to service such a great community of truck guys.
Made in the USA. You guys are probably cranking them out nonstop. A ton of our audience is out there buying these trucks, building these trucks, and they know, hey, Painless Performance has got me taken care of.
Factory options, aftermarket stuff. If you have any questions, call our tech guys. They'll walk you through anything you need to know, and we'll make sure your truck gets wired up right the first time.
If you want to clean up your underdash, you want to clean up your chassis, it's that easy. PainlessPerformance.com, PainlessPerformance.com. Thanks, Andrew.
All right, guys, I've got Phil from Week's Auction, and Phil and the family, Uncle Chuck, I think is what you said. So Chuck was the main man. He's like a big John Wayne guy, and he's doing some auctioning. And then you did some auctioning too. You kind of stepped in. But one of the things I said, hey, I want to interview Phil or somebody from the auction company, and you said, I don't know anything about this stuff. But you do, because you ran the auction, and you guys did a really good job, and it was a lot of fun. Well, the reason why I want to interview and the reason why I think it's cool is you don't know, you guys are farm equipment, right? So it's a family business. You're here in Grand Island, local company. How cool is that? You guys probably go all over and do farm stuff. Sure. Is this the first time you've done a truck auction at all and or to this scale?
Yeah, to this scale. First of all, I don't think there's been a lot of auctions like this anywhere, let alone here in central Nebraska. But for us, we've never done anything to this magnitude where we've got an offering like this with so many rare trucks, trucks you'll never see again, really quality offerings, whether it was completely restored, all original, whatever it might be. There's really something for everyone here today. We've never seen anything like this here in central Nebraska, and certainly just very fortunate to be a part of it here today.
All right, so here's the deal. Did you grow up with trucks? Did you grow up with Ford trucks, classic trucks, on the farm, auctioning, and just Phil, not auction Phil, but did you like these trucks? I mean, it was cool. And you were out there auctioning and auctioning parts, and there was times where you kind of knew what you were talking about. You were talking about, you're like, okay, OBS wheels or this. And so I figured you've been around trucks, but again, just the whole thing that you guys did, it was fun. It was fun to see it. And so I kind of want your perspective of what we saw.
I definitely don't have the knowledge base that most of our participants here today had, but growing up, my first truck was a 1990 OBS Chevy. Probably never should have got rid of that truck. Great truck. TBI motor, ran forever. I think the only thing we ever did to it was maybe change the oil in a battery or two. But growing up, kind of a quasi motorhead. You know, I liked vehicles, liked fast cars, had a couple fourth gen F bodies growing up, and most of my buddies were, you know, somewhat gearheads, like to race cars, derby, things like that. So, you know, just being around the people, I can pick up a little bit here and there. So just tried to learn as much as I can, kind of take it all in from Todd and Dave and everybody else that was helping out here, and try to learn as much as I could about the stuff as I was going through, helping cataloging everything, learning more about the truck. So that way, when we had people calling from all over the state or all over the country, for that matter, we had people in other countries calling. I think almost every state in the United States was represented, and you know, my phone number's on the webpage, so a lot of these people are calling me. So I just tried to educate myself the best I could, so I could answer their questions with some semblance of knowledge.
What was one of the most craziest calls or something? Because I think at one point you said the proxy bid went down, and boom, the first person they're going to call is probably you, and they're frantic, and they're like, "I want to bid on this. I don't want to miss it out," and then it's stressful.
Aside from that, you know, I think my favorite call was, I think it was on Thursday, the auction went viral on Fox News, and it just blew up. It crashed our webpage, server overload, couldn't handle the volume from Fox News. And later in the afternoon, I got a call from a very friendly gentleman from Alaska, of all places, and said, "Well, I just saw this on Fox News. Me and my boy, we're super excited. We're coming down. We're hopping on a plane tonight. We're going to be there on Friday. We're going to come in, get checked in early, come in and see what you have." I just thought that was super cool that somebody would see this, know that it's a once-in-a-lifetime event, and they're not going to miss it. But yeah, we had we had some issues there with just, quite frankly, just overload for our server. We had some people get kicked off proxy bid, which that happens, you know, on both ends. And, you know, they were calling in saying, "Hey, I'm not going to miss this truck. Get me in. I don't care how, but get me in somehow." So we tried our best to accommodate everybody we could. And all in all, you know, the proxy bid worked great. We had over 1,000 online registered bidders, and from all over the world, sold a couple of trucks overseas. Platform worked really well for us today. All in all, you know, great event.
How many bidders did you have here, registered bidders?
We had over 400 registered bidders on site, but you know, most bidders are bringing a couple people with them. We had sold a plethora of gate passes, people who just wanted to come in, see everything that there was to see. I don't have an official tally on that right now, but I know we had well over 400 registered bidders here today.
So you guys normally do farm equipment, stuff like that. What would be one of the biggest challenges or the differences between the two? Obviously, I understand you're selling old classic trucks, but you're still selling stuff. And, right, you know, I guess if you're an auctioneer, you can sell anything. And Uncle Chuck seemed like he could sell just about anything. The beginning was kind of fun because it was slow. And there will probably be some changes that happen because of that, right? So it was, you know, some cabs and some truck beds and some wheels, and just your uncle's sense of humor was on point, and it lightened the mood, and you could tell he could sell things. So back to the original question of what would you say is the biggest difference and or challenge, farm versus classic trucks?
Well, I think the biggest challenge there is every auction has its style, and auctions are something that's very regional. So if you go to an auction here in central Nebraska, there's a couple firms that do auctions around here. We all kind of have the same style. Start with smaller items, wait for the crowd to get there, get warmed up, and then move into the bigger, better things. Whereas you might go to some other region, and they might start with a primo of the primo of the auction. I mean, they start with a bang. It's just, it's a highly regional, and it's a highly specific thing to the type of auction. So I think the biggest challenge was reading the crowd, because we have people from all over the country here today. And thank you, one and all, for traveling out to Grand Island, Nebraska, being a part of the day today. But just getting a feel for the crowd, what they wanted, how they wanted the sale to take place, what pace they wanted to go at, and then, of course, accommodating all of our online bidders, because, as you know, there's a slight delay with your online bidding. You know, trying to respect the people that are here and spend all day with us here today, while also allowing those people that are bidding online their chance to bid as well. I think that was probably the biggest challenge, is just balancing out the two between your online bidders, your people on site. And I think, you know, the weather held out great for us today. We had a wonderful day. I think everybody here on site had a great time, and really it ended up working pretty great.
I couldn't agree more. We talked about that with Dave Hall. I haven't had the chance to interview Big T-O-double-D, but I think you guys nailed it. All right, last thing, what would you say, what are you taking away from, whether it's a personal experience or professional experience, of the people, of the trucks, of everything, and what you think about the 100 Square Body Auction?
My biggest takeaway, and something that me and Chuck and all the staff talked about, is just the general positive attitude and how great everyone was to work with. You know, we were checking in people early on Friday. We were checking in people most of the day today. Everyone was super patient. They realized they were here for a major event. There was going to be a lot of people, a lot of moving parts. Everyone was in a great mood. Everyone was just super happy to be here. And just really the people that we are working with. I mean, you don't often get a chance to work with so many people that are just happy to be at an event and know that it's something special, and everyone was getting along, and just, I just can't say enough about the people and the customers we are working with today that really made it a great event.
We love to hear that. One of the things we say, you know, is the trucks are cool, but the people are cooler, and it just, it's nice to hear that from other people, because we live in a bubble, or you know, I'm in this bubble, and I love the people that interact within this truck community. But it's really cool to hear, especially when you think about farming people, farming community, you think about the most down-to-earth, salt-of-the-earth, genuine people, and you're around those type of people. So it's cool to hear a complete and total outsider, somebody I haven't even met until this weekend, seeing you guys, seeing you in the front office, seeing you auctioning at one point, seeing you in the Popemobile, working, shaking, doing so many different things that we don't really realize that have to happen. Accountability, obviously it's a big deal how much things are going for. You guys did a great job. Thanks for everything, and we're glad you had fun.
Sounds great. We're just grateful for the opportunity, and thanks for letting us chat.
Sunday, post 100 Square Body Auction. T-O-double-D, this guy pulled it off. I'll be honest with you, we're sitting in the car at the airport. He's getting ready to drop us off, and I was like, dude, I want to get 5 minutes. So, holy shit, dude, you did it. The Big Fish Auction, the 100 Square Body Auction, your team, all the fellas, and what's it feel like to be Todd Carpenter today?
So I feel good. I had some buyer's remorse, or not buyer's, seller's remorse, I guess I would say. When you first do an event, I kind of look up to guys now that put on events, because there's so much work into, you know, putting on an event, getting everything going, getting all your vendors and your, you know, everything, everybody else set up, and you don't know how it's going to work, because you have no idea, because you've never done it. So I really just winged it, to be honest with you, and we had everything set up. The parts, we didn't have them laid out right, and we didn't have, it's the only thing that was kind of the negative drawback, I guess, you know, was parts. People got good buys on them, and I don't know, maybe it was something maybe cheeky to charge $100 to come in to bid, but on what I was trying to do was to protect the bidders. You go to a lot of auctions, especially small town or smaller auctions, and it's almost a free event, like a state fair almost. And the people that are there just want to see things go down and the auction ways. And, you know, I wanted to keep the serious bidders, because there's been a lot of auctions where you have bidders and they can't even get close to the vehicle. They can't open it because there's so many people.
So I'm like, I just want to weed those, really those people out, because I want to protect the bidders, you know?
Yeah, and I think, you know, I don't know what the head count was, whether, you know, 400 or 500 bidders, and then you had, you know, two people with each one of those, or let's just call it 3,000 people. I really don't know, but I know you guys will go through the numbers. The flow was great. I mean, I know at the beginning it seemed a little slow, but that was fine. It you know, you're not going to be off racing with the highest bid. You get people going back there. You guys were in the Pope Mobile. You were cruising up and down. And the timing was perfect too. I was a little worried about the timing. And then you guys just kept going. Were you surprised? What would you say was your biggest surprise out of the whole thing? Like, when you think about the people that were bidding from Kuwait or all over the country, what do you think was the biggest surprise for the whole auction?
You know, most auctions, usually 5% is internet buys. Okay, 5, maybe 10, if that. I mean, that's most. I would say 60-65% was internet. And maybe it was because we're rural, nowhere, Nebraska. You know, maybe people had a lot of other stuff going on. It seems like everybody has stuff going on. So the internet bidding was huge. I know when we started off, when we first got online, there was over 700 registered bidders that registered for this auction. And at one time when we first started, we had 340 going bidder, internet bidders. And then throughout the day, it was always, I don't know if we lost our mojo when we dropped back in, but it dropped back down to 100 and whatever. And I don't know, maybe people were done buying whatever. And then we got up to some of the higher end stuff, you know, I mean, but the main thing about this one was it was a 60-65% was internet was probably the biggest surprise of anything.
Well, and Dave, I interviewed him yesterday, and he said it's about a 75% sales rate. So he was pretty excited. I'm sure you are as well. And you got to think, most of those guys, those internet guys, even guys I know that didn't make it out, they're going to be, you know, they're going to be watching. They're going to be flying over thinking, where's the deals? Where's the deal? Halfway through it, or by the time you get to those last two rows, you know, you're probably getting a good feel that, okay, now they're past the bargains. And so that might be a reason why some of that stuff dropped off, because then you were into the heavy hitter stuff. You got into the primo stuff, which I think the way you laid it out was perfect. I think the front row was, you knew that was the big sellers, and I think the flow seemed great from the perspective of where I was.
Yeah. So when we set it up, it was just going to be a regular auction, and then let's make it a little small one day, small town Barrett Jackson. You know, let's have booze. Let's have food, let's have entertainment, let's have a good time, let's bring truck guys together, let's enjoy it, you know. And so at a small town is, you know, and I wanted to clean up the property. I had a lot of parts, and a lot of parts did go cheap, I'll be honest with you there, but it didn't bother me. You know what, it was, yeah, they're going cheap, but you know, my famous saying, you haven't heard yet, I'll catch them on the backside, you know. Or the guy go, you know what, I told one guy, and I know he had some friends that were bitching to him about paying the $100. I ain't paying the $100. I just got to get some transmissions and get this stuff and whatever. I ain't paying $100 to buy all that stuff, though. He goes, so this guy goes, I bought a motor for $30. That was probably worth, you know, $300. And I go, well, you go tell your boys that they were stupid for not paying that $100, because they came in and got some stuff cheap and it made it up. But you protected the bidders. People had fun. Things sold. We actually had a few that we sold 7 trucks today that didn't hit the reserve. People called, say, what was going on? Okay, well, let's make the deal afterwards. There it was. So they're still, and we have several phone calls coming in, and we got a call back on Monday, but it pretty much, everything that needed to sell, sold.
You sold the Outfitter, your 76 GMC Grecian Bronze Estate Suburban. You sold the Spirit of 76. You sold 4 or 5 chalets. What's going to be the one that is going to be that might sting or you're going to miss, or that was toughest to sell, because you sold some of your primo stuff?
Yeah, you know, my Spirit of 76 went to a good home for now anyway. I know he might probably resell it, but that Outfitter was pretty near and dear, you know. Of course, I think you tried to buy it from me.
I tried to trade you orange slice for it before you went crazy on it. So yeah, I think I'm I'm happy that we didn't do it, but I do like that thing.
Yeah, so that was a good one. Yeah, there's a few, but I'm telling you, I had to buy a pallet of batteries before this auction, and I don't wish that on anybody.
Yeah, Channing, I don't know if Chan mentioned it in the interview, but I know at one point in the weekend I asked him, he said over 60 batteries.
Yeah, so it was like roadkill on steroids for one day. We're like, we got to get everything right. We got a mile of trucks, and we got to all get them running. So, you know, we were in there getting everything because a lot of stuff has, you know, been sitting for a couple of years or whatever. Like, let's get this fired up and get whatever fixed and get her in line. And, you know, so the pre-auction on anything was, you know, getting it all going was quite something. But, yeah.
Now that you've got it, I'm going to go catch my flight here, and I'm going to let you go. But now that you've got it, you said it. Hey, it was a lot of work, but now you've got one under your belt. Another thing that, as you're kind of talking about, trucks sitting for a few years and batteries, is I can only imagine you're gonna hunt down, you know, some trucks for another potential auction, and those trucks will be a little fresher. You've got the recipe down, you've got the location, you've got the guys, you've got the staff, the party. It was a party. It was one of the funnest things I've done. So thank you for that. Do you think you'll do it again?
Right now I'm not, because I'm clearing up the aftermath, and once you get done, you still have to deal. The ripple effect will probably go on for a couple more months by the time you get everything cleaned up and everything's situated. Believe it or not, everybody paid. You know, it was, we collected all the money, and that's what the auction company said. And I'm like, wow, all right, that's good, you know. And I asked Dave, I says, well, we'll talk to Dave here in another 4 or 5 months and see if that's, maybe we'll get back in and maybe change it up a little bit, because we kind of know. When you're first one out of the gate, you really don't know what you're doing. I'm being honest. You think you do. And we got some good press, you know, and it worked out. We might do it.
All right. Fox News blew up on Friday. Maybe it was Thursday. Thursday or Friday, they were out. Some guy from Alaska saw it on Fox News, and I think he came out.
He flew out, and he goes, I'm coming out. Can I get my bidder's badge? I'm like, you're flying out the next day. He goes, absolutely. From Anchorage, Alaska, and I met the guy. I can't remember his name now because I had so much stuff going. I met so many people, I forgot who all I met. But I met this guy from Anchorage, Alaska. He flew in, him and his son. He sees it on Fox News, calls in. Well, it crashed our website. And then after the website got back up, the phone call started coming in. And then he hopped on the next day from Anchorage to Nebraska. And I don't know what that trip cost, but he really wanted to be here and buy some stuff. So it was good. It definitely interesting. It was just good to see everybody. And
yeah, you got to meet some new people and hang out with some old buddies. And it's always good. So for you guys out there, I'm going to let him go because I got to go catch a flight. But you did it. Absolutely did it, and it's got to feel good. A lot of hard work. I hadn't seen Todd since the reunion. He looked like he probably dropped 30 pounds, and you've been working. Your tan looks good. Awesome job.
Thank you. And you know what? Thanks to my guys. They had to put up with me for a pretty hard 90 days. Dave Hall, Restore Muscle Car, his crew. He's got a good crew. Dylan, Mark, Tyler, everybody there at Restore Muscle Car. Honest God, it would have never took off without them guys. And then, of course, my guys for setting up the deal. So it kind of worked good. It was a good joint adventure.
All right, the Big Fish boys, you know who you are. There's a whole group of you out there. And then T-O-Double-D, nice work, brother.
Thanks, buddy.
242 in the books, the first 100 square body auction, Grand Island, Nebraska. So much fun seeing all of the homies, meeting some new people, and I look forward to doing it again. As always, thanks again for tuning in. Have a great week.
Yo, man, let's get out of here. Word to your mother.